गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू दी ऑनलाइन टीचिंग सेशन ऑफ आर्यंत इंग्लिश मीडियम स्कूल सोलापुर। सो आई एम टीचिंग हिस्ट्री फॉर द स्टैंडर्ड सिक्स्थ। सो द न्यू लेसन फॉर स्टैंडर्ड सिक्स इज द इंडियन सब कॉन्टिनेंट एंड हिस्ट्री। सो देर आर थ्री इंपॉर्टेंट सब टॉपिक्स इन दिस लेसन। फर्स्ट वन इज ज्योग्राफिकल कंडीशंस एंड द कोर्स ऑफ हिस्ट्री। सेकेंड, geographical features of India, very very important part, and third one, the Indian subcontinent. So we'll see. In the fifth standard we saw at some length that there is a close relationship between man and his environment. So we saw how the changes in lifestyle of the early man and his technology were related to the changes in his surrounding. We also reviewed the history of human civilization from the Stone Age to the agricultural civilization that flourished on the bank of river. Yes, we studied that how human civilizations occur from the Stone Age to the agricultural civilization on the banks of major rivers like Sindhu. So the history is current account of the significant past event in the progress of human culture. Yes, history is nothing but the account of past event. Time, place, society and individuals are the four major pillars of history. We cannot write history without them. We cannot write history without time, without place, without society and without individuals. So that's why it is called as the major pillars of history. Of these four components, place is related to the geography or the geographical conditions. Yes. In this sense, history and geography are inseparable. Yes, they are related to each other. History and geography both are related to each other. History is influenced by geographical conditions in many ways. Yes, history is influenced by geographical conditions. Our diet, clothing, housing, occupation. In fact, all human life in any region depends to a large extent on its geographical characteristics. For example, the life of the people in hilly regions is more strenuous than that of the people on the plains. Yes, those who are living on the hilly region, so their life is very hard because they don't have proper diet, proper clothing they don't have housing facilities, their occupation is not like us. Means everything is changed. Everything is different by a large extent. Understood? So, the climate, rainfall, agricultural produce, flora and fauna, means the animal and animal life of the region where we live, are the sources of our livelihood. Not much fertile land is available in the hilly region, and in the plains it is available on large scale. So that is why grains and vegetables are scarce in hilly regions. Yes, scarce means lack of. So the grains and vegetables are not more than plains. Means in hilly regions they don't have that much vegetables and grains like us. So that is why grains and vegetables are scarce in the hilly regions. In comparison, people on the plains get them in a sufficient measure. Yes, we can get in sufficient measure. Naturally, this has an impact on the diet of the people. This has an impact of diet of the people, the quality of food that we get and that those people get. So there is changes. So in hilly regions, people depend more on hunting and gathering the food. Yes, the main occupation from the hilly region people is the hunting and gathering the food. We also find such other differences in the lifestyle of the people in the hilly region and those of plains. Yes, the people who are living on plains, so they means the clothing style is different. Our and means we are living on plains, but the people, those who are living in hilly regions, so the dressing style also changes. So the climate, rainfall, agricultural produce, flora and fauna means animal life and plant life of the region where we are live are the sources of our livelihood. Yes, all these are the sources of our livelihood. Our climate is our source of livelihood. Rainfall agricultural produce, all these are the sources of livelihood. The lifestyle and culture of a region develop with their support. Our lifestyle, our culture of our region, so develop with their support. Human settlements have flourished wherever the means of living are plentiful. Over a period of time, these settlements develop further into villages and towns. Yes, human settlements flourished wherever the meaning or means of livelihood are plentiful, where the water availability is plenty, climate is good, the rainfall occurs, agriculture produce can produce, means we can produce well, then only we can settle there. No, if all these are scarce, then we can't settle there. So over a period of time, these settlements developed further into villages and towns. Yes, first the first human settlements settled besides the river or on the coast of river. Understood? Then these settlements expanded and made the villages and towns. But sometimes reasons like degradation of environment, drought, again invasions, means attacks of other countries or enemies, led to the scarcity of those means. By this, the people or the societies can transfer, understood, or they can migrate. So people were forced to leave their settlements. Yes, that's why the people are forced to leave their settlements. They migrated somewhere else. Villages and town become deserted due to the drought or invasions. They ran away. No, we see many such instances in history. Thus, we see that there is a very close relations between history and geography. That's why there is close relation between history and geography. So now we have to see the geographical features of India. Very important topic in this lesson. We have to see what is mean by geographical features of India. Our country India extends far and wide. Yes, our India is very far and wide, means very big in size, big in area. At its north lie the Himalayas. See, at its north side, Himalaya is there. I'll show one presentation to you. See, at its north, here Himalaya. Understood? Next, at the east, Bay of Bengal is here. To the right side of this map, Bay of Bengal. Next, to the west, means left side, the Arabian Sea. Arabian Sea is here, left side. Arabian Sea. And to the south, the Indian Ocean. To the south, downside of this map, you can see the here is Indian Ocean. So except for these, for the islands of Andaman and Nicobar, very right side corner, you can see Andaman and Nicobar. And Lakshadweep, left side, near in Arabian Sea, Lakshadweep islands are there. The rest of the country is contiguous. It means what? Our country, rest of our country is continue. Understood? It is very far and wide. But two parts are separated from our mainland. They are Andaman Nicobar and Lakshadweep. So we have to take into account this region. Hence, referred to as ancient India. When we studied ancient history of India before 1947, today's Pakistan and Bangladesh were also the part of India. Yes, this Bangladesh was part of India, and here the Pakistan also the part of India. In 1947, Pakistan separated from India, and in 1971 that Bangladesh separated from Pakistan. So the following regions are seen to be important when we look at the course of Indian history. So some regions are important. So which are those regions? Regions we'll see now. First one, the Himalayas. Second, the plains of Sindhu, Ganga and Brahmaputra rivers. Third, the Thar Desert located in Rajasthan. The Deccan Plateau. It lies in our Maharashtra. Next, the coastal regions, the sea coasts. Next, the islands in the seas that I explained. Islands like Andaman, Nicobar and Lakshadweep. Both are separated from our mainland. So that's why, and they are located in seas. So see, Himalayas. These are Himalayas. The Hindu Kush and Himalaya ranges have created an impenetrable wall on the northern side of Indian subcontinent. Yes, Indian subcontinent to the Indian subcontinent, there are two main ranges, Hindu Kush and Himalaya ranges. And they have created an impenetrable wall to the north side of Indian subcontinent. It protects us, Himalaya protects us from the north side. So, however, there is a land route through the Khyber and Bolan passes of Hindu Kush mountains. Khyber and Bolan, these are the two passes. Passes means the route between two mountains. Passes means the route between two mountains. So the Khyber and Bolan, these two passes are from Hindu Kush Parvat or Hindu Kush Mountain. This route was connected to ancient trade route. Yes, in ancient times, the trade activities from this region only. So, the trade route from China passed through Central Asia and reached Arabia. From this Khyber and Bolan passes, the trade route started from Central Asia or started from China, passed to the Central Asia and went to the or reached to the Arabia, that is Saudi Arabia. It is known as the Silk Route or Silk Road. Mainly the production of silk or why this route is called as Silk Route, because the silk, the transport of silk was made from this river, these passes. So because of silk was the main commodity exported to the western countries by this route. The route through the passes was used by many foreign invaders to enter the ancient India. Many foreign travelers also come to India by this route. Yes, many foreign travelers also come India by this route. Second, the plains of Sindhu, Ganga and Brahmaputra. Very important, the plains. You can see the plains of Sindhu, Ganga and Brahmaputra. So the region consists of the basins of the three big rivers, Sindhu, Ganga, Brahmaputra. These three big rivers, the region which contains the three big rivers are called as the plains. So where these plains located, we'll see. In north region, near Pakistan, near Ganga flows through this region. And Brahmaputra from Arunachal Pradesh to this region. Understood? Means this northern side of India, there are the northern plains. So we'll see. So we'll see now. Sindhu, Ganga and Brahmaputra and their tributaries occupied this region. So this is Ganga River, you can see. This region extends from Sindh, Punjab in the west to the left side near Pakistan, or the boundary of Pakistan. So this region extends from Sindh, Punjab in the west to the present day Bangladesh in east. To the right side, very wide area. So it was in this region that the earliest Indian civilization of Harappa and the latter states and empires of ancient India emerged. In this region only the states of Harappa or the civilization of Harappa and other states emerged in this region. Empire means the big kingdom or big state in area is called as empire. Third one, see now, so third one is Thar Desert. Thar Desert spread across Rajasthan. Thar desert spread across Rajasthan. So it is desert. This desert spread across Rajasthan, Haryana and some part of Gujarat. That's why Rajasthan is called as Registan. Understood? Rajasthan is also called as Registan. So sand is there only. That's why it is called as Registan. So the Thar desert spreads across Rajasthan, Haryana and some part of Gujarat, the northern part of Gujarat. So the part of the desert lies in today's Pakistan also, means some part of Thar desert lies in Pakistan also. So the Thar desert has the Satluj river to its north. Yes, to its north there is Satluj river. Next, the Aravali mountain range into east. So the Aravali mountain ranges are located in Rajasthan. Please underline your textbook. Aravali mountain ranges are located in Rajasthan. Next, the run of Kutch to its south, to the south in Gujarat. The run of Kutch is located in Gujarat. So located to the south side. And next, the Indus, that is Sindhu. Sindhu river to its west, to the left side there is Sindhu river. So you can see the page number 4 of your textbook. The Ghaggar river that originates in Himachal Pradesh reaches the Thar desert. It is known as Hakra in Pakistan. So the Ghaggar river emerged or originate in Himachal Pradesh and reaches to the Thar desert. To the west side, flows to the west side. So this river is known as Hakra river in Pakistan. Its course in Rajasthan and Pakistan now has dried up. Means this river dried up because of the desert. Many sites of Harappan civilizations are situated along now the dry course of the river. So many Harappan, means we studied in 5th standard, Harappa and Mohenjo-daro civilizations. So the many sites are located in this region are dried up. Next one, Deccan Plateau. Deccan Plateau located in Maharashtra, mainly in Maharashtra. So see, the region between the east and the west coast of India tapers this to the south. The region has the Arabian Sea to its west. See, the region between the east and west coast of India, left side, east and west coast of India, means left side there was, means there is west side, and to the right there is east side. So the region between these two coast and some part of south is called the Deccan Plateau. This region has the Arabian Sea to its west, the Indian Ocean to the south. To the left side of this region there is Arabian Sea. I'll show you. You can see here, these are the coast. This left side Arabian Sea, to the right side, yes, you can see this left side Arabian Sea, means in the west Arabian Sea to its west, Indian Ocean to its south, to the down Indian Ocean is there, and to the right side, means the east side, there is Bay of Bengal. So the region thus bound by sea on three sides is called peninsula. Very, very important. Peninsula means what? The region bounded by the sea on three sides is called peninsula. You can see this, I'm showing, this is Indian Peninsula. So this region is bounded by three sides, no? South, east, west. Only the northern part is surrounded by Himalaya. But these three sides are bounded by sea. That's why it is called as peninsula. A major part of the Indian Peninsula is occupied by Deccan Plateau. It's a major part of Indian Peninsula is occupied by Deccan Plateau. This region is occupied by Deccan Plateau. year. Next, the mountain ranges of Vindhya and Satpura are located in to the north of this plateau. Yes, that I am showing mountain ranges. The mountain ranges of the Vindhya and Satpura are located to the north of the Deccan Plateau. The Sahyadri mountain ranges are to its west. See, when we are going from Pune to Bombay, so we can see the Sahyadri mountain range. They are also known as Western Ghats. To the west of the Sahyadri is the coastal region of Konkan and Malabar. Yes, to the west side we can see here the Konkan and Malabar. In pink bracket you can see to the left side the Konkan coast and Malabar coast. From Karnataka to Kerala it is called as Malabar coast, and from some part of Gujarat to Maharashtra it is called as, in still Goa, it is called as Konkan coast. So the mountains on the eastern side, in the right side we can see the mountains to the eastern side are known as the Eastern Ghat. Left side are Western Ghat, right side is Eastern Ghat. You can see this black in color, one border is there. So Deccan Plateau has fertile land where the many post Harappan agrarizations and cultures are flourished. See, Deccan Plateau has very fertile land. We can see the black soil. Understood? In Solapur, means Solapur is located on this Deccan Plateau. So we can, means the black cotton soil occurs in this region. We can see the black cotton soil, very smooth black in color. So Deccan Plateau was the part of Maurya Empire, the largest in ancient India. Yes, the Maurya Empire. Deccan Plateau was the part of Maurya Empire, the largest empire of ancient India. After the decline of the Maurya Empire, several other kings and smaller empires continued to flourish in this region. Yes, some other kingdoms were continued to flourish in this region, continued to rule in this region. Understood? Next, the coastal regions. Very important, coastal regions. From the time of Harappan civilization, we studied in fifth, Harappan civilization. So from the time of Harappan civilization, ancient India had trade relations with the Western countries. Yes, we had trade relations with the other countries. This trade was carried on by sea.